As the next thing, I want to introduce a definition. Namely, I want to formalize a notion which is related to convergence in some way, because there might be occasions when you have a sequence given and you can kind of see or compute that the terms of the sequence, like in some measurements or whatever, they kind of are close to each other, that you really kind of, they are really closer and closer together, but you can't really recognize a limit. You can't see that a sequence converges. And so, of course, if you want to write down a definition of a of convergence, you need the limit. You really need to show that your epsilon close to this limit, and you need to know this number. This notion where you don't need the limit is the notion of Cauchy sequence. Definition 250. Okay, this again works both in the real numbers and the context numbers. So a sequence in K is called a Cauchy sequence. Cauchy was a French mathematician. I don't know precisely when he lived. A Cauchy sequence, if the following holds, and now this looks very similar to convergence, for all epsilon bigger than zero, there exists an N0 in N, such that, and now we don't have a limit, but we just want that An and Am are very close to each other for all sufficiently big n and m. So this means the absolute value of the difference of the two, An and m, smaller than epsilon for all m and n, which are bigger than n0. Okay, so here we don't need any limit. Now, one might ask, what happens, so what's the difference between the notion of a Cauchy sequence and a convergence sequence? And the answer is there is none. Namely, theorem 251, a real sequence, we will treat the complex case later, a real sequence is convergent to some limit if and only if it's a Cauchy sequence. If and only if it is a Cauchy sequence. Okay. And this is actually not too hard to prove. Okay, first we go in this direction, so we assume convergence. So that An be a real sequence with a limit, so this converges against some A, which is a real number. Okay, now that epsilon be bigger than zero, just some number, we need to show that there's an zero and n such that this really holds. Okay, then we use the convergence of an. There exists an n0 in n such that the following holds. An minus a is smaller than epsilon over 2. Yes, it's one of these proofs again. Smaller than epsilon over 2 for all n bigger than or equal to n0. Then, if m and n are both bigger than n0, we can take the difference an minus am to the absolute value and now subtract a and add a inside this number. And you see why I do this, namely because I can use the triangle inequality again. Okay, the triangle inequality then says that this is smaller than or equal to an minus a to the absolute value plus am minus a to the absolute value. I just changed the sign in the second part. And they are both smaller than epsilon over 2. And this gives, of course, epsilon for all m and n bigger than or equal to n0. Okay, so and this shows that an is a Cauchy sequence. Okay, now for the converse, this is the point, and so you, up to this point you might ask, why is he doing this now? Now there comes the reason, because now we need the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem indeed. So we go in this direction. So let it be, let An be a Cauchy sequence. Oops, Cauchy sequence. So then in particular, so what we now, the idea is now, we take this Kolchak sequence, we want to show that it is bounded, then by Bolzano-Weierstrass we get a convergence subsequence, and we want to show that the convergence subsequence, so this convergence property plus the Kolchak property, results in the convergence of the whole sequence. So this is what we're going to do. So first of all, we need some upper bound. And for this purpose, we just take a particular epsilon, namely, we particularly know that there exists an n0 in n, such that an minus an0 is smaller than 1 for all n bigger than or equal to n0. It's just a particular case of epsilon equal to 1 and of just fixing the value of m. So this is what we always get. Then we know, and now again, having fun with the triangle inequality, the absolute value of an is smaller than or equal to, if we now subtract a and add it again, I won't do this explicitly here, this is smaller than or equal to an minus a, sorry, we don't have any a, sorry, an0. We subtract an0 and add n0, let me do this, yeah, maybe this one's here, okay, sorry about that. This is smaller than or equal to an minus a, n0, again by the triangle inequality, plus an0 to the absolute value, and this is then estimated from above by 1, so this is smaller than an0 to the absolute value plus 1 for all n bigger than or equal to n0. Okay, this an0 is a fixed value, so this is really a fixed upper bound which does not depend on n, and so we can do now a similar trick to what we did before, more or less the same trick, with c, a constant. So here we have bounded everything from n0 on, so we just need to maybe erase the bound to get the first n0 minus 1 terms of the sequence. So we need to take the maximum of the absolute value of a1 to da 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 until an0 minus 1, and finally an0 to the absolute value plus 1. This is a real number. We get that the absolute value of an is smaller than or equal to c for all n in n, which means this sequence is bounded. So now, by Bolzano-Weierstrass, there exists a convergence subsequence. A and k, k and n. Okay, convergence subsequence, and we define the limit of the subsequence by A. And now we want to show that the whole sequence also converges against A. So limit of A and k is A. Okay, now we need to combine this convergence with the Cauchy property. So first of all, the Cauchy property. So since that epsilon bigger than 0, I just made a mess in my notes. That epsilon bigger than 0, then there is some k0 in n. This is just the convergence of the subsequence, sorry about that, such that a and k minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon over 2 for all k bigger than or equal to k0. Now, since a n is a Cauchy sequence, there is also, with respect to the same epsilon, there is some number k1 in n, such that the absolute value of an minus am is smaller than epsilon over 2 for all m and n, smaller than or equal to nk1. So we can just assume that this particular n, since we can always increase it, is part of the subsequence. So we've got these two things. So now we just take k2 to be the maximum of k0 and k1, so just need the bigger one of them. Then, for all n bigger than or equal to nk2, we can do the following: an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than or equal to, and now we can subtract nk2 and add it again, which means that we get a n minus a n k 2 plus a n k 2 minus a. Okay, now we know since this was just an arbitrary n, here we are part of the subsequence, and since this k 2 is so big, we know that this is at most epsilon over 2, and here we are also, since we are big enough, this is also bounded by epsilon over 2, so this is smaller than epsilon over 2 plus epsilon over 2, which is epsilon for all, had it already in the beginning, for all n bigger than this element. So this here, this nk2, this is our n0, so to say. So this really gives the convergence. So since epsilon was arbitrary, this shows that the limit n to infinity of an is a, so an converges to a. This is what we needed to show. Okay. The complex case, maybe I can include this here. I just will not prove this. I've already also included a proof in the lecture notes. One can again use the real case and derive the complex case. Corollary 252. A complex sequence is convergent if and only if it's a Cauchy sequence. Convergent if and only if it is a Cauchy sequence. Okay, we'll not give the proof here, but I've included a proof in the lecture notes if you're interested. So again, one takes the real case and derives the complex case directly. Okay. Yes, let me just erase. Before we move on, I have a final remark on Cauchy sequences. Namely, they are very closely connected to the completeness of the real numbers. Remark 253. So far I've formulated Cauchy sequences and defined them only for real and complex numbers, but in theory, all you need is a field, and you need some absolute value. So you can need to work with them in this with respect to this absolute value. And then you can really use this convergence of Cauchy sequences this can be used as an axiom. So if we define this for a field and use and say axiomatically that every Cauchy sequence is supposed to converge, if we put this axiom onto an ordered field, plus an additional axiom that we've kind of seen as the theorem, I won't go into details on this, the so-called Archimedean axiom, then you can replace the completeness definition, which we defined by existence of suprema of subsets bounded from above. You can replace this then by the convergence of Cauchy sequences, and to demand this. Just not my strong side, so this can be used to define complete fields. Complete fields. So I won't go into details on this. So in the calculus, so that's also not important for us, just for the people who are interested in this. If you look at standard calculus textbooks, some will really use this as definition of complete fields, but this isn't the way we go. Okay, so much for Cauchy sequences. Now there's another concept I want to introduce, namely, we occasionally have this situation, like when you think about this, the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem, where we had sequences with convergent subsequence, where the whole sequence by itself did not converge, but subsequences kind of run and they accumulate at a certain point. So these sequences really tend to converge towards a point, and so parts of the sequence accumulate. So can we see, this notion of accumulation is what we are going to formalize in general for sequences without using the notion of subsequence. And this goes the following way. Let again k be the real numbers or the complex numbers, so we could do it in both settings. And let an be a sequence in k. Then a value a in k is called an accumulation point . Some books also call it a limit point, an accumulation point of the sequence if the following holds, if the set of all n in n, such that the corresponding element of the sequence an is epsilon close to this value a, such that this set here is infinite for every epsilon bigger than zero. Okay, so especially if we have a subsequence which converges against a value, then basically you can see that infinitely many terms of the subsequence lie epsilon close to this value, and so that this is how we get our accumulation point. I will make this precise in the next theorem. And yeah, so this is, first of all, a notion which doesn't require subsequences or anything. But the relation to subsequences, we can really make this one precise. Namely, I formulate this as a theorem. So again, an, a sequence in R or C, a sequence in K equal to R or K equal to C, and A, an element of K, then the following statements are equivalent. Okay, let me start with a new blackboard so I get all three on the same board. So the following are equivalent. First of all, the first statement, A in K is an accumulation point. Of the sequence AN, second, for all epsilon bigger than zero, and for all n in n, there exists some n in n which is bigger than capital N. So n bigger than or equal to capital N, such that a n minus a small n epsilon. So no matter how big we choose our index, there's always some element of the sequence following, which is still epsilon close to this accumulation point. This is kind of a nice way of formulating this without this set explicitly. Okay, and the third condition is there exists a subsequence converging to this. So this notion of accumulation point, which didn't need the subsequence, really is equivalent to the notion of the limit of some subsequence. So there exists a subsequence. Sequence a n k, where k is our new index, which converges against a. So limit k to infinity, a n k is equal to a. Okay. So to prove this, first of all, before I prove this, I want to give you some idea of proof strategy. So formulate this as a remark. General strategy. If we have to show that several statements are equivalent, so technically we need to show that A1 is equivalent to A2, which is equivalent to A3, and so on and so on, to some statement an. And now very formally, we also need to show that every ai is equivalent to every ij, but this can just be shown by following these arrows, so that this is really, that they are really all equivalent. But to show this, we of course have to show many implications. So we these say that we have implications here in this, in this, in this direction, and to the other direction, this, 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 this. So we have a lot of implications that technically would have to be shown, but to show this, it suffices to show fewer implications. Namely, it suffices, this one possibility is we show that A1 implies A2, show that A2 implies A3, and so on, until we reach AN. And then finally, we kind of close a circle by showing that AN implies A1. Because now
everything applies everything. I mean, if we have some
I which is smaller than j, we have some ai, we can just follow this line and say this implies I aj.
So if we have some, let's say we want to show that a3 implies i2, or in general that they are kind of, that the one which is kind of further here, and where the number here is bigger, that this implies the one with the smaller number. This now follows,
since we can just follow this implication, and this implies this and this. And so this means that we again arrive here and can follow here. So from A3, it follows that A4 it follows, and so on, and so on, and so on. Then it follows that AN is true. Then it follows that A1 is true. Then it follows that A2 is true. So we can just kind of build a circle here.
And of course, we could do this the other direction. We could also simply show that, basically work our way backwards, that an implies an minus 1, which implies an minus 2, and so on, until we at one point reach a1, and then need to show, basically, again closing the circle, that a1 implies an. And then by the same argument, just reversed, this shows all implication. And as you see, we just have to show always one direction for each, so this really saves some time. So if we have some statements and you have to show that they are all equivalent and it's kind of more than two, then usually one of these things should work best. So we want to create such a circle. And this is also how we're going to prove theorem 255. Okay, the first implication is quite short, so I should get this in here somewhere. So proof of theorem 255. Okay, we want to show that 1 implies 2. So if we have an accumulation point, then this statement that for all epsilon bigger than 0 and for all n, we have some index bigger, which is then epsilon close. This is very easy because we know that by assumption that for all, that this it's an accumulation point. So for all epsilon bigger than 0, the set n in n such that an minus a is smaller than epsilon, this is infinite. Okay, but then it follows that if we make one additional assumption, we say that n, the set of all n in n for which, again, an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon, and we just demand that n is bigger than or equal to capital N. Okay, if we take a look at this set and this set, the difference between those two, so the only thing is that we demand that N has a certain minimum size. This means we can only, from going from here to there, we only drop finitely many elements. So if this is infinite, this still has to be infinite. Is infinite. Hence, in particular, and this is already sufficient for us, it's non-empty. So we can find such a small n, which is bigger than or equal to n, such that this holds. So this means 2 holds. So 1 implies 2. This is what we've already shown. And for the other implications, let me quickly erase the board. The next implication that we're going to see is that 2 implies 3. So this condition that for all epsilon and capital N, we can find some small n bigger than capital N, such that we're epsilon close to the accumulation point, or to this element A. From this point, we need to derive that there's a subsequence convergence to this A. And so we really need to construct such a subsequence. This can be really done explicitly, as we shall see now. So the first element of the subsequence, we just choose an N1 in N, such that AN1 minus A to the absolute value is smaller than 1. Okay, for all epsilon, we have infinitely many elements. We can find elements and so on. So we can, in particular for epsilon equal to 1, we can find such an element. Okay, this exists, so by assumption 2. Okay. Now, we do this inductively. Assume that we have now found, given n1 smaller than n2, and so on, so indices for our subsequence until the kth element. We take nk plus 1 in n. This is, should be given such that the following holds. We want that, first of all, that nk plus 1 is bigger than nk. to make sense of our sequence. And we want that a n k plus 1 minus a to the absolute value is smaller than 1 over k plus 1. Okay, these exist by part 2. We just need to choose epsilon as 1 over k plus 1. And capital N would then be nk plus 1. Then we precisely get such an element. Right? So if we construct it in this way, we get a subsequence which has a nice property. Namely, if we really assume that every element of the sequence is constructed by this step, so every element here also has this analogous property of an inequality here, then it follows by construction an minus a to the absolute ank minus a to the absolute value is smaller than 1 over k for all k and n. And now it's time for this sandwich principle, so the squeeze theorem. We see this converges to 0. And we see that this is an absolute value, so it's bounded from below by 0. It's just by definition of the absolute value. And so we see this is, again, squeezed in, so in between the 0 sequence and 0 itself. And so this is precisely the case of the corollary 229 of the squeeze theorem. This implies then that this middle thing here is convergent and that this indeed goes to 0. And this only goes to 0 if this can only be the case because the absolute value becomes 0 only if the element in between is 0. So this means that a and k converges to a. And so we found the subsequence we were looking for. Okay, so to close our circle, we now have to do the third implication. And this means we need to go from this third condition and from this third statement and show that this implies the first one. And then we've got our circle closed. Okay, so we have some convergent subsequence. I need to show that this limit is an accumulation point by definition. And this is basically, I've given this argument verbally a moment ago, so that ank be a subsequence which converges against this element a. So a subsequence with limit k to infinity ank is a. So assume we have this. Then, if we take an arbitrary epsilon bigger than 0, we need to show that the number of elements of the set epsilon, elements of the sequence epsilon close to a is infinite. And this is almost obvious now, because we know that just by definition of convergence, for every epsilon, we have a k0 in n, such that ank minus a to the absolute value smaller than epsilon for all k bigger than or equal to k0. But this means the set of all indices nk for which k is bigger than or equal to k0 is a subset of the set of all indices n and n such that an minus a to the absolute value is smaller than epsilon. And this set is infinite, which means this set is infinite, and so we're good, because this shows the latter set is infinite, and this is the condition of an accumulation point, since we have chosen epsilon against an arbitrary positive number. So this shows that it's an accumulation point. Okay. So accumulation points are the same as limits of subsequences. But of course, since we cannot, it's a really tedious thing to study all subsequences of a given sequence. So of course, it's kind of an infinite number of them. So this is, of course, not that easy. And so the notion of accumulation point is a bit better to handle directly. And so to get some convergent subsequences, if we can find such points which have these properties. OK, first of all, something I like to remember. I would just want to reformulate now a theorem we had before, namely the theorem of Bolzano-Weierstrass. So by this previous theorem, and the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem,
this means that every bounded sequence has a convergent subsequence, and so by this theorem, every bounded sequence, every bounded sequence in R or C has an accumulation point. Okay, so bounded sequences have accumulation points, always. Okay, this was quite dry, actually, so let's do some examples, and we can see that in the examples, if you really want to determine accumulation points, it really goes to the study of subsequences in general. The first sequence I want to study is an is equal to minus 1 to the power of 1 plus 1 over n, where n in n. Okay, here we see we've got some kind of converging part and some part which is flipping the sign. But here we can see kind of how we can define subsequences which should converge, namely when this flipping doesn't occur. And this doesn't occur if we take either all even indices or all odd indices. And so let's do this first. Let's study these sequences. So we get that if we take k to infinity and take the subsequence a to k, so the set of all even numbers, this means, even indices. This means then that this part here is precisely 1. So this is then 1, and here we get 1 over 2k. This obviously goes to 0, and by the computational limits, computational methods for limits, this shows that this limit is 1. And so the same for the odd indices. These can be described as a2k plus 1. This means we get the limit of k to infinity, and this time this alternating part here, this is always negative, so we get minus 1 plus 1 over 2k plus 1, and this again goes to 0, so this is indeed minus 1. So this then shows that, first of all, we have seen now that minus 1 and 1 are accumulation points. Of the sequence. And then you can see that there are no other accumulation points, because for any convergent subsequence of an, okay, the problem is now, if it would kind of alternate between the even and the odd part, of course the signs would be flipping, and so the distance between two subsequent elements would always be positive and be bounded from below by some positive number. So we're really jumping here back and forth. And so this, if something is converging, then either it somehow has to kind of stay within this range at some point, so or it stay within this sequence at some point. So we can't have any more accumulation points. So every convergent subsequence of this, either almost every element lies in this sequence. So I'm a bit sloppy with the definitions here, with the terminology here, but you know what I mean. So either this happens, or almost every element lies in this odd part, so in all a2k plus 1. And this means that if we take the limit, I mean, almost every element lies in there, so it's either kind of up to finitely many elements which don't care for limit purposes. The rest is then a subsequence of this or of this, and we know that subsequences of convergent sequences converge to the same value, and so this means we can't have any further accumulation points. So minus 1 and 1 are the only accumulation points. We have one part of the sequence which goes to minus 1 and one part to 1, and that's essentially what the sequence is doing. The only accumulation points of an. Should we write smaller? I have to erase again. Then we'll give another example. The next example is a quite simple one. We study maybe the most simple sequence, or one of the most simple sequences I can imagine. I just take an equal to n for every n in n. Okay, we've seen this before. I mean, this is, of course, pretty obvious. What happens here, this sequence is unbounded, and, of course, every subsequence of an
is unbounded as well. Because if the indices become very big, this means that the values of the sequence become very big. So unbounded sequences are not convergent, so all subsequences of this are divergent. And so by the previous theorem, which says that accumulation points only occur as limits of subsequences, this doesn't have any accumulation point. This has no accumulation points. Okay, so this happens. You cannot assume the existence of an accumulation point the same way that you cannot assume the existence of a convergent subsequence if the sequence is not bounded. Okay, another example. The next sequence is defined case-wise. Let an be either n or 1 over n, and we let it be n if n is even, and 1 over n if n is odd. Okay, so this is also kind of alternating between two different sequences. Here, this is an example of an unbounded sequence which has an accumulation point. So we see that an is unbounded. Again, since this here, this part of the sequence is exploding, this is unbounded. But it has an accumulation point, since we can see here we can build a convergent subsequence. Namely, 0 is an accumulation point of the sequence an, since simply the limit of k to infinity of the odd part, so of a to k plus 1, so this is 0. Right, this is just 1 over 2k plus 1, and this goes to 0. So this is really an accumulation point of the sequence. So unbounded sequences can have accumulation points, but don't need to have accumulation points in general. Okay, so much for this direct definition and the examples. Now, these accumulation points can now also be studied we can introduce some interesting notions that already have some applications in the following sections, which now might look a bit strange in the beginning, but let's just first give the definition. This time we assume that we have a real sequence. Otherwise, the following is just not well defined. Part A. If the sequence is bounded from above, okay, as I said, the sequence doesn't need to converge, it's just some real sequence, but we can define something which is not called the limit, but the so-called limit superior. And this is the following. We write this similar to the limit, but we do not write lim, but lim sup. Limit superior, so lim sup. So this lim sup of an, this can also be denoted in a more short, in a shorter way by limit with a bar on top. This notation I will also occasionally use simply because it's shorter in the proofs, but sometimes I personally prefer to write this because you can easily misread this by not seeing the line or whatever. So, but we will alternate between the two notations. So now, what's the definition? So this is simply the supremum of all accumulation points. The supremum of all A is an accumulation point of the sequence AN. Okay, this is now might now look a bit awkward because you might ask yourselves, why do we find this as a limit? Because there's no limit on this side here, there's just a supremum. There is an alternative way of writing down this definition as a limit, precisely as a limit of a sequence of suprema of subsets. This definition is officially, I think the official term is horrible. So it's really, quite complicated. I try to reduce the simpler one because this is all we need, but the other one you can do a bit more formalism and some, but we leave this to the mathematicians. This is just enough for us. So keep in mind, you could define this as a limit. This is why it's defined in this way, and we will see that's kind of in some way how it, what it has to do with limits of sequences. So this is the limit superior. This is in the bounded case. There's no space here, so let me here continue. If it's not bounded from above, then we simply put
lim sup n to infinity of a n to be plus infinity.
Okay, now where there's a limit superior, there's a limit inferior. We can do the same way from the other side, namely, that's part B of the definition. If a n is bounded from below, bounded from below, it's limit inferior. And now it's everybody's guess how this will be defined. This is the following. We denote this not by lim sup, but by lim inf, n to infinity, or in this shorter notation, so of a n, or in this shorter notation, we again take limit, but this time we do the bar below the limit. So from below, from above, that's how this, the reason for this intuitive notation. And this is then simply defined as the infimum of the accumulation points. Okay, and if it's not bounded from below, bounded from below, we just put lim inf n to infinity of a n to be minus infinity. Okay, just for computing purposes here. So, what does this mean? So we have kind of we have the supremum of accumulation points or the infimum of accumulation points. So we kind of the question is now what do we know about this value itself? What does this have to do with accumulation points? And there it turns out these numbers are themselves accumulation points. So actually we could write instead of sup and inf, we could write max and min since they are really part of this set actually, if we have a bounded sequence. So theorem 260 that. We just do the bounded case, bounded real sequence. The key is, I mean, we could now treat differently the case bounded from above and lim sup, or bounded from below and lim inf, but I just want to keep it a bit concise. So a bounded real sequence, then the limit superior and the limit inferior. A n are themselves accumulation points. Accumulation points of A n. And this proof is actually quite nice. I like it personally. Okay, we will only give the proof for limit superior because the other case is completely the same. So only for lim sup, the lim inf n to infinity is really done analogously. You just need to flip some directions of some inequalities, but the arguments are precisely the same, so it's easy to reconstruct for anyone to get the proof there. Okay, this proof is so nice that I want to have a nice clean blackboard for it, so let me just erase. Okay, we now define this limit superior as S, so that we don't have to write all that much. This is the limit superior of a n. And now we want to show that this is really an accumulation point itself. And there, basically, we need quite some things that we did before, but not in a very complicated way. So again, let epsilon bigger than 0. Okay, by definition of S, this is the supremum of all accumulation points. So the smallest upper bound of the set of accumulation points, this means by definition of S as a supremum, we know that there exists an accumulation point A of the sequence AN, such that S minus epsilon over 2, yes, one of these proofs, S minus epsilon over 2 is smaller than A, is smaller than or equal to S. So, because otherwise this would be another upper bound for the set of accumulation points, but since this is the smallest upper bound, this cannot be. So we know that this holds. Moreover, since A is an accumulation point, the set which I will name M, just to have a short name for this, the set of all n and n such that the corresponding element of the sequence a n lies epsilon over 2 close close to a. So okay, here we've got epsilon over 2, here we've got epsilon over 2, although here it was barely readable, sorry. So this since this accumulation point, this set is infinite. But then, if we take some n outside out of the set M and take a look at the difference between an and the supremum and this S, this is then the same as an minus a plus a minus s. Here we go with the triangle inequality. This is an minus a plus and the value of a minus s. Since a is more than equal to s, we see that this holds, this is s minus a, but from this inequality we get that this is smaller than epsilon over 2. Combining these, so here we get that this is smaller than epsilon over 2, simply if we take an index out of m. Here we get this is smaller than epsilon over 2 because of this relation, and this is smaller than epsilon, and this holds for every n in m. So this means, just writing this down as a set, M is a subset of the set of indices n and n, such that an minus, s is smaller than epsilon. And this means, since M is infinite, this set's infinite as well. So the latter set is infinite. Okay, and epsilon was just an arbitrary number. So since epsilon was arbitrary, this shows that S is an accumulation point. Of an. Okay, the same method goes for the liminf. The only difference is basically that here the inequalities change a bit, but this is something you can fill in easily. Okay, so this shows that they are, again, accumulation points. Now, the problem is now that with, and this is now a nice theorem, it's making a nice statement about bounded sequences. So we know that we've seen so far, it's basically some theorem that will summarize everything and that will show why this is so interesting. So assume we have some bounded sequence, some bounded real sequence. Okay, we've studied subsequences, we've seen Bolzano-Weierstrass and so on. So the idea is now that the sequence might not converge, but we see that if n goes to infinity, so if we see this as some point in R which is kind of jumping all around in some bounded range, we see that at some point it will stay within a certain range, and this range is given by the accumulation points. This means for large n, we might not get convergence, so the sequence may jump and jump and jump, but it will jump within these accumulation points somehow. And this is basically some theorem which kind of generalizes the convergence property or convergence definition, namely, for all epsilon bigger than 0, there is some n0 in n such that, and now we don't, of course, don't know if it's close to some limit, but we know that an is contained in the following interval, liminf of an minus epsilon and lim sup n to infinity an plus epsilon. So we've seen like this example with minus 1 to the n plus 1 over n, the sequence. This had the accumulation points minus 1 and 1. So in this case, this interval would be minus 1 minus epsilon, and here would have 1 plus epsilon, which is, of course, an interval of positive length. So it's really, there's no convergence or anything, but we see that this is kind of some infinite range of the sequence. So we will stay in some area, so we will stay close to this interval, epsilon close to this interval, if our term is big enough. So that, for example, if you kind of measure the position of a particle, which is kind of widely behaving, you kind of know that for its long-term behavior, it will kind of stay within a certain range of elements of the within a certain interval that we can then further discuss or investigate. Okay. So much for this. So this is this nice statement, and this we are going to prove. So let epsilon bigger than zero. Now we take a look at these elements of the sequence which kind of do not do what we want. Namely, we want the set M1, which we define as the set of indices such that AN is not in this interval, but bigger than this interval. So AN is bigger than or equal to the lim sup of AN plus epsilon. So that's the number of elements for which it's too big. Now we take the set of elements for which it is too small. So n and n with a n smaller than or equal to lim inf n to infinity a n minus epsilon. Okay, so what we want to show is that these sets are really finite. Then we can find some index which is just bigger than everything contained in these two, which has this nice property. But we just need to show that these two are finite. And this we do by contradiction. So we assume that M1 is infinite. Okay, if it's infinite, then we know that there's a subsequence in there because we can just, sort the right, the indices in the right way, just kind of take the right ordering to get a subsequence which is completely inside M1. So there exists a subsequence, ANK, such that nk is element m1 for all k in n. Okay, but since the sequence is bounded, its subsequence is also bounded. So this is bounded, and this means by Bolzano-Weierstrass, it has a convergent subsequence. There exists a convergent subsequence, which we call, and now we have fun with triple indices again, NKL, okay, L and N, so it's very popular notation. Now I'm happy that the lecture hall is empty, so no one can throw stones or tomatoes or something at me. We have another nice triple index, so this is a convergent subsequence of A and K, and since it's a subsequence of this, it's also a subsequence of the big one, so thus of A N, N and N. Okay, so we have a convergent subsequence which lies completely in this range. But now we can use an observation from much earlier, namely, first of all, sorry, this is something I also forgot to mention. We have a convergent subsequence, so this means that its limit is an accumulation point. This is the theorem from before. So A, which I will denote as, so by the limit L to infinity of A n k L. So this is an accumulation point of A n. Okay, now we're getting back to this old result. Namely, we know that every element of this subsequence lies in this range, so every element of the subsequence is bounded from below by this particular value. And this means, this is what we've seen in the corollary. That was corollary 227. The limit of the sequence, if the whole sequence is bounded from below by this element, then the limit is bounded as well. So this implies that A is bigger than or equal to lim sup of AN plus infinity, but here we go, here we have contradiction, because this is the supremum, this is the biggest accumulation point, so there can't be other ones which are bigger. So, contradiction, since lim sup n to infinity an is the biggest accumulation point. In this case, we've seen it is really an accumulation point. Okay, so this means that M1 is finite. So for M2, we can do the same thing,
just replace everything by liminf and limsup by liminf and kind of reverse the inequalities, then we would get the kind of we have a subsequence whose limit is too small, which would be smaller than the smallest accumulation point. So the same analogously M2 is finite. And now we're almost done. Since now we can just say, so this is finite. And if we put N0 to be the biggest element of the union of M1 and M2, so so big that we're kind of in the, that we've almost exceeded this, and then add 1, we are outside of M1 and M2, and forget about it completely, and all what's coming after N0 is just behaving nicely and not like in these two strange sets. Okay, I shouldn't point in this direction because you can't see that blackboard, I just realized, sorry. Let me optimize the blackboards anyway. Okay, so this is well defined, since these sets are finite, of course. And we know that just by construction, An lies in this interval liminf minus epsilon and limsup plus epsilon. And this holds true for all n bigger than or equal to n0. And epsilon was just an arbitrary number, so we're finished. Okay. Yes, now I'm almost done with the section, so maybe let me use the final blackboard to do this here before erasing, because it's only very few things left to come. So we've seen that in general, so this this theorem here, so this kind of generalizes convergence in some sense. So we have for bounded sequences, we can do say something about this range of the elements. So what does this say about convergence? This has a simple corollary, 262. And I need another piece of chalk, because this one's gone. If we have a real sequence, sequence, and we have some number A and R, then the convergence of an element, of the sequence to an element, sorry, AN converges to A. This can be equivalently expressed by saying that we want first that the sequence is bounded. And then there's another condition. The liminf of An coincides with the limsup of An, and they both, of course, equal A. So this is really an equivalent formulation of this without using convergence explicitly, just using accumulation points and boundedness. So proof of this, this is actually quite basic. We're kind of just throwing enough theorems together. So this direction here, this was what we've just shown. So in this case, if these two coincide, then this is just this interval A minus epsilon, A plus epsilon, and this is really the definition of convergence. So there's nothing left to show. This is really, this follows from theorem 261. And the other direction is also simply by putting enough theorems together. We combine theorem 255 about accumulation points and so on, namely 255. Theorem. Let me just check which I've got this in my notes. I just have to check what I need to say with this. Yes, if it converges to A, then we know that we've seen that every subsequence of a convergent sequence converges to the same value. So every subsequence of the sequence converges to A as well, which means that there can be no other accumulation points. The only accumulation point is A, because for every accumulation point, by this theorem, we must have such a subsequence. So the only accumulation point we can get is A. So these here are the sup and inf of a set with one element, A. So it's just A itself, right? So this is this then follows from this theorem. So we need to combine this with theorem 219. This is what says that the subsequence of a conversion sequence converges to the same value. And simply that we get this boundedness property. This was what we've already seen. That was theorem 210, that every convergent sequence is bounded. And this shows the corollary. So yeah, you might fill in details yourself. This might be a bit quick, but this is kind of how you can also define convergence in terms of these quantities. OK, so much for this section. Yes, so just keep in mind, everything when we consider dim-inf and dim-sup and so on, this only works in the real case. For complex sequences, for complex numbers, there's no such thing as a supremum and infimum. This really works in the because we need the ordering of the real numbers, which we don't have in C. OK, so much for this. In the next section, we will start to tackle the second part of the headline of this chapter, namely series, which is actually a special case of sequences, and so shouldn't be too hard, although some people find it hard to imagine intuitively, but I hope we'll give it a good ride. Okay, so see you in the next video.